Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Sapna Dadwal. I'm working as a professor in the Department of Management at St. Andrew's Institute of Technology and Management. This is Lecture 8 of Unit 3 of Organizational Behavior. This subject is taught in CAC, ETC, Civil Engineering of 4th semester. The topic I'm going to cover in this lecture are, I'm going to discuss definition of group, stages of group development, types of group, definitions of team, then merits and demerits of team. Starting with first, definition of group. A group can be defined as two or more interacting and interdependent individuals who come together to achieve particular objectives. A group behavior can be stated as a course of action a group take as a family. For example, strike. A team can be defined as a group of people coming together to achieve a particular goal. So it is very clear from this what group is. It is two or more person interacting together for some common objective, to achieve some common objective. Now types of group. So there are two types of group in an individual form. They are formal groups and informal groups. Let us know about these groups. First is formal groups. These are the type of work groups created by organization and have designated work assignments and routed tasks. The behavior of such group is directed towards achieving organizational goals. The formal groups further classified into two subgroups. First one is command group. It is a group consisting of individuals who report directly to the manager. So different departments may be called as command groups. For example, all the employees who are working in a finance department, they will be directly reporting to a finance manager. It is same with the marketing department. It's same with other departments, sales department, production department, HR department. So these are called as command group. Then comes task group. Task group is a group, and in task group, the people working together to finish a job. So people work together for a particular task, and as the task completed, that sometimes these groups dismantle. So they are actually working together for a particular task. So these groups are called as task group, which are formation. The formation of these groups are made for till the completion of that particular task. Now the second main category of groups is informal groups. These groups are formed with friendship and common interest. These can be further classified into subgroups. For example, interest group. First one is interest group. It is a group formed by individual working together to achieve a specific objective. Example, a group of workers working on a project and reporting to the same manager is considered as a command group. But a group of friends chilling out together is considered as a interest group, or say members of a club. Then comes friendship group. Those brought together because of their shared interest or common characteristic is known as friendship group. Now, next topic, stages of group development. So forming a team or forming a group is just like maintaining a relationship. It takes time, patience, requires support, efforts, and members often go through recognizable stages as they change from being a collection of strangers to a united group with some common goals. So Bruce Tuckman presented a model of 5 stages. These stages are forming, storming, norming, performing in order to develop a group. So I'm starting with first stage, that is forming stage. This stage is also called as orientation stage. So the first stage of group development is a forming stage. This stage present a time where the group is just starting to come together and is described with anxiety and uncertainty. So members are discreet with their behavior, which is driven by their desire to be accepted by all members of the group. Conflict, controversy, misunderstanding, and personal opinion are avoided, even though members are starting to form impression of each other and gain an understanding of what the other group will do or what the other group member will do together. So typical consequences of forming stage include achieving an understanding of group's purpose, determining how the team or a group is going to be organized and who will be responsible for what, discussions of major milestone or phase of group goal that includes a rough project schedule, outlining general group rules that includes when they will meet and discovery of what resources will be available for the group to use. So at this stage, group members are learning what to do, how the group is going to operate, what is expected and what is acceptable. Now comes second stage, that is known as storming stage or power struggle stage. So the second stage of group development is of storming stage. The storming stage is where dispute and competition are at its greatest, because now group members have an understanding of the work and a general feel of belongingness towards the group as well as towards the group members. So this is the stage where dominating group members emerge, while the less confrontational members stay in their comfort zone. So questions around leadership, authority, rules, policy, norms, responsibilities, structure, evaluation criteria, and reward system tend to arise during the storming stage. Such questions need to be answered so that group can move further on to the next stage. Now comes third stage. This is called as norming stage or cooperation and integration stage. In this stage, the group becomes fun and enjoyable. Group interactions are a lot more easier, more cooperative and productive, with way, give and take, open communication, bonding and mutual respect for each other. So if there is any dispute or disruption, it is comparatively easy to resolve and the group gets back on track. So group leadership is very important, but the facilitator can step back a little and let the group members take the initiative and move forward together. Then comes next stage is performing or synergy stage. So once a group is clear about its needs, it can move forward to the third stage of group development. That is from the norming stage. So this is the time where the group becomes really united. So performing stage is the time where the group becomes really united. At this stage, the morale is high as group members actively acknowledge the talents, skills and experience that each other brings to the group. A sense of belongingness is established and the group remain focused on the group purpose and goals. Members are flexible, interdependent and trust each other. Leadership is distributive and members are willing to adapt according to the needs of the group. Now comes the last stage, that is adjourning or closer stage. This stage of a group can be confusing and is usually reached when the task is successfully completed. At this stage, the project is coming to an end and the team members are moving off in different directions. This stage looks at the team from the perspective of the well-being of team instead of the perspective of handling a team through the original four stages of team growth. Now the next topic is definition of team. So according to Joan Kajenbein and Douglas Smith, a team is a small number of people with complementary skills who are committed to a common purpose or set of performance goals and approach for which they hold themselves mutually accountable. So any work group whose individual effort result in performance that is greater than the sum of individual input is called as work team. So all the groups are not team. So the above definition helps to differentiate between these two, that what is team and what is group. So team is generally, in a team the members are small, whereas in a group the members can be, groups can be large and can be small. Teams are generally small. A small number of people work as a team. Now characteristics of effective team or teams. So Rensis, Likert and Douglas MacGregor were among the early writers who directed attention to importance of team functioning. They identified some of the characteristics of well-functioning effective teams. First is, the atmosphere tends to be relaxed, comfortable, and informal. So in teams, generally the environment or atmosphere is relaxed, comfortable, and informal. And the team task is well understood and accepted by all the members of the team. Then the members listen well to each other, and there's a lot of task-relevant discussion in which most members participate. All the team members express their feeling and ideas in the team meetings. Then conflict and disagreement are present but are centered around ideas and method, not around personalities and people. So decisions are usually based on consensus, not on majority votes. So these are the characteristics of team. Now merits and demerits of team. The teamwork implies a number of individuals striving towards a common goal. Depending on your personality, you might either love or hate working in a team. So working in a team could prove to be an incredible learning experience where there is a readiness among the members to share information with one another. Each member trusts and supports each other, and also there is willingness to stand by one another in time of crisis. Now comes merits. So first merit is it promotes creativity. So when employees work together in a group or in a team, they are often times able to collaborate together to brainstorm innovative and creative idea to benefit the organization. So many organizations form diverse teams, which allows these teams to draw from the experiences and abilities of one another. So diversity within team is beneficial because people from different backgrounds and culture approach problems and topics differently. So teams are also more productive when they are cognitively diverse. So it is very clear, the first merit is teams promotes creativity in the organization. The second merit is the team working in a team generate motivation in the employees. So team members working together in harmony are able to motivate one another. The sense of accomplishment received from working with productive team increases employees' morale and causes employees to desire to achieve greater success. Motivated employees benefit the organization by providing excellent customer service and increase in efficiency and productivity. Third merit is teams helps in building trust among employees. So another advantage of teams within organization is that working as a team can build trust among employees. Employees who trust each other do not compete with others unnecessarily. So they understand that working together is for the benefit of the organization. Employees who trust one another are more willing to work together in the future and ask for help from each other when needed. Now the next merit is it creates positive synergy in the employees as well as in the organization. So teams have the potential to create high level of productivity due to positive synergy created by them. The output in the form of performance productivities is generally more than the summation of inputs put in the form of employee effort. So there is a drawback of positive synergy also. Sometimes management resort to cuts in staff to use the positive synergy and get the same or greater output from fewer people. Now the next merit is satisfaction of social needs. So teams also satisfy the needs of the people of social needs. So man is a social animal, we all know. He always feels the need of affiliation. Teams can satisfy this need of employees by increasing workers' interaction and creating a feeling of brotherhood and friendship among team members. Such employees are always in a better position to cope with stress and they enjoy their jobs more. Then next merit is commitment to team goals. So team generally develop a common purpose, commitment to the purpose, and agreement upon specific goals. All this combined with the social pressure exerted by the team result in high degree of commitment to common team goal. Now, next is improved organizational communication. As the team encourage interaction, it will lead to improved communication. In case of self-managed team, interpersonal dependencies are created which require the members to interact considerably more than they work on job done. So it is very clear that working in a team improves the organizational communication. Then working in a team it is a benefit of expanded job training for employees. So the implementation of teamwork always leads to expanded job training. This training employees build their technical decision making and interpersonal skill. The next is organizational flexibility. So management has found that teams are more flexible and responsive to changing events than a traditional department or other form of permanent groupings. Teams have the capability to quickly assemble, deploy, refocus and disband. All this is because of the reason that teams focus on process rather than function. So they encourage cross training so the members can do each other's jobs and expansion of skills. So teams, working the teams actually enhances the flexibility, organizational flexibility. Now, demerits of team. Interpersonal conflict. One disadvantage of team within organization is the possibility of conflict arising between team members. So one team member may disagree with the ideas of another team member, which may lead to an argument. Then second is compatibility problem. One of the disadvantage of working in a team is personal incompatibility. Some employees work better by themselves than in a group. So an employee who doesn't work well with a group can hinder the progress of the entire team. So the incompatible employee may dispatch himself from the rest of the team and refuse to participate. And if the negative feeling arises from the rest of the team members towards the incompatible employee, communication may suffer within group. Then free riding issues. Some team members may take advantage of the effort that other members take within the team. This can cause issues with the group members group because the team members making the effort may feel like other team members are coasting along and not pulling their weight. So if this issue is not handled immediately, unmotivated team members may feel entitled towards not putting forth the same effort as other, and they demotivate other employees also. Now, loss of efficiency. At the same time, many organizations have found the team often failed to work as effectively and efficiently as they had hoped. Sometimes the decision-making process within team is such that there is lack of quick and responsive action. This may occur when the team hasn't established protocol or a process for decision-making, or where there is lack of clarity about the team leadership. Then next advantage is lack of effective communication. So communication among team members often is difficult. This might be especially true of teams that have not had much experience working together in the past. Assigned tasks, overall goals and feedback can be misinterpreted, meaning that intended messages are lost and outcome of the team's work becomes something very different what had been planned. Now the next disadvantage is personality conflict. While bringing together people from variety of department and viewpoints can help foster a sense of unity in organization, but it also lead to a substantial team conflict that can damage the morale of the organization and derail the team success toward achieving its assigned task. Now, these are the questions which are related to the above topics. If any query is there, please do contact me. Thank you. Thank you so much.